you who don't know, SBAC in a nutshell is a nationally administered standardized test that has major financial consequences for our schools. How it works is, if your school has money, your kids do better on SBAC, and then you get more money. And if your school doesn't have money, your school doesn't do well on SBAC, and you get even less money. These ethics and this logic make no sense. And the moment that I had with my student today was her realizing that injustice in a new way. And it brought me back to a time when it seemed like, even though I was just with her, and we were having a moment sharing in the indignity of that injustice, it brought me back to the time when it seemed all of Oakland understood injustice. When it seemed all of Oakland stood up and rallied together with the teachers to strike for the rights of our children. As a teacher, it was a time of early nights and early mornings and late nights, and thousands took to the streets to march down 98, flooded the state building, and rallied at Frank Ogawa Plaza. And yes, it seemed like Oakland teachers, finally, we found our voices, but it made me realize that Oakland as a whole was singing out against the injustices that our children bear the burden of. This was a time of unprecedented solidarity within our communities. It was humbling and heartening and awakening to realize our interdependency upon one another in the struggle that we were going to win by only communal means necessary. Today, I had to tell my student about injustice, but I was not alone. I wasn't alone as Kia Walton, a sixth grade math teacher at Elmhurst. I wasn't alone as a union rep. I wasn't alone as a laborer, because who stood by me? We're the same people who are sitting and standing by us today. These were not just classroom teachers who saw our struggle. These were like-minded laborers who recognized that the dismissal of rights in one area of our society is the dismissal of rights in every area. They answered the call to action, AFSCME, SEIU, DSA, ACE, our recreation centers, our libraries, and dozens of other community programs, organizations, and unions came through to stand with us to fight for our students. In our most vulnerable time, and equally our most empowered time, you stood with the teachers of Oakland, who stood for the students of Oakland. And now educators of Oakland, if there's any educators in the crowd, this message was always just for you. We must continue to move forward with a spirit of unity and locate ourselves within the labor movement. We are not indebted to, but we must recognize that we only won this strike because of the solidarity of the people who are not in our classrooms, but the laborers who write, the laborers who do hospitality, the laborers who clean, the laborers who build. We have to recognize that we are a part of this. We are laborers together, and the only way we are going to win is together. As a classroom teacher, I stand alone every day in front of 30 children. And I feel that isolation. I feel that sense of aloneness that makes it seem like you can't go on. And yes, we may labor and toil in isolation, but Oakland, we will liberate in community. That is the only way. Thank you for your time, Oakland Sin Fronteras. Thank you for your time, Oakland. I will see y'all on the lines. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kia. We really appreciate you and all the work you do every day with students in Elmhurst Community Prep. Make some noise for Kia Walton and all of our educators. So up next, we have Alice Loaiza. She lived in Colombia for many years where she worked with Marcha Patriotica and continues with them in California with the Task Force on the Americas. Alice va a hablar de punto 6 de los puntos de unidad, y eso es la importancia de terminar la agresión militar y políticas de los Estados Unidos. So make some noise for Alice!
Alerta, alerta, alerta que camina, la espada de Bolívar por América Latina. Alerta, alerta, alerta que camina, la espada de Bolívar por América Latina. How many of you know what happened in Venezuela yesterday? Another coup. another intent of coup by the United States. The United States has it out for Venezuela. Yesterday, they armed a coup that they thought was going to take over the government of Venezuela, and they thought was going to take Maduro out of power. But the great people of Venezuela rallied and were able to defeat that coup in Venezuela, to defeat the United States, and to defeat the right-wing Juan Guaido and all of the right-wing that follows him. It was a fantastic day in the sense that it ended with the strength of the Bolivarian Revolution in Venezuela. Why did they want to end Venezuela? 20 years ago, Hugo Chavez began and carried out with the people of Venezuela the Bolivarian Revolution. The Bolivarian Revolution is for sovereignty, for the no U.S. intervention and no foreign intervention in Venezuela, and for popular programs for people to be able to eat, for better education, for health care. And those were began in Venezuela. They worked in Venezuela. They're way better. You go to Venezuela, it's way better right now than it is in Colombia for all of those things. So what does the U.S. say? That's an enemy. For the people, it's an enemy. We've got to change that. So the U.S., as it's done all over the world, and certainly in Latin America, you can look at Libya, you can look at Iraq, you can look at Guatemala, you can look at Haiti in 2004, you can look at Honduras in 2009, and on and on and on and on are the coups that the United States has performed throughout Latin America and throughout the world. Now, what are they doing in Venezuela? It's not been so easy, because the people are behind the government. It's a regular recipe for coup. First of all, what do they want to do? They want to destabilize the government. So they want sanctions. They want to stop all of the entrance of money into the country. So Venezuela sells its oil, and the banks can't give Venezuela the money for the oil. They're not allowed. If they get their hands slapped, they get something happen. If they're not taken care of, they can't do it. Another thing they do is they're leaking out the subsidized food and the subsidized gasoline from Venezuela. They're taking it out through Colombia and selling it and not permitting it to be sold within the country. So they're trying to destabilize economically. They're trying to destabilize politically. They're forming paramilitaries in Colombia and they're infiltrating into Venezuela. That is what's happening now in Venezuela. They're trying to, they've got Juan Guaido, who's some creep that they cooked up, you know, a few months ago. And, you know, it's just another one that they decided that he was going to be president of Venezuela. Nobody knows who he is. I mean, you're certainly not elected. Maduro is the legally and most transparent elected government of Latin America. He was elected. A year ago in May, he was elected. And he's not a dictator. So what does the U.S. say? He's a dictator. We have to get rid of him. And then they have this mass media, barrage of media of lies. So the United States, CNN, NBC, all of it here, and all of it in Latin America, basically tells people that Maduro is a dictator, that Maduro's the fault, that it's his fault the electricity went out. That was sabotage by the United States to knock over the Maduro government. We here have to pressure. We really need to pressure the United States to be out of Latin America and against the white, racist, capitalist, imperialist, take of the government that we have. Thank you very much.